In this week's video, we're going to be looking at these pulse oximeters. We're going to be looking at how it works. We're going to look at how to use them. We're going to be looking at how to use them to monitor your COVID-19 symptoms. We're going to be looking at buying guides. We're going to look at analyzing results and loads more. So, what are we waiting for? Let's begin. Now, I appreciate this is going to be quite a long video. So, if there's any specific information that you are looking for, I'm going to leave a chapter down below. You can click on whichever section you want. Click in that description. Click on whichever chapter you want, which has got the information that you're looking for, and watch the video. Or, if you're really interested in pulse oximeters, watch the whole video, and at the end of it, you will become a pulse oximeter pro. Okay, so let's begin with what is a pulse oximeter. So pulse oximeters are a medical device that fit on part of your body. They come in different shapes and sizes, but essentially what they do is they measure two things. First of all, they measure your heart rate. So that's how fast your heart is beating. And second of all, they measure the saturation, your oxygen saturation, which means how much oxygen is exactly in your blood at that moment in time. So most pulse oximeters that we use have a clip-like function like so. It's got spring in the back, so when you push it, it opens and closes. You pop your finger in it, and then the good news is that it uses no needles or anything painful like that to tell you your results, to tell you oxygen saturation and your heart rate. So it uses what we call red light and infrared light. Infrared light, we've seen it all the time. You guys have it at home. You've got a remote control, for example, that is using infrared light. So a very basic explanation, both of them types of lights are passed through. It passes through your skin and it's a sensor on the other side which measures exactly how much of this light passes through. From this, it's able to calculate the ratio of light that passes through, which is able to calculate your oxygen saturation and your heart rate. That was super simplified, but that's all you need to know. So pulse oximeters have been used for many years in many different scenarios. You may have seen them used in ambulances, during surgery, in hospital. We use them in medical practices during acute care to assess a patient to see how they're doing. And most recently, pulse oximeters are being used to monitor COVID-19 symptoms. So this means if you suffered from COVID-19 symptoms or you've currently got COVID-19, your healthcare professional may have given you a pulse oximeter to use at the moment so they can monitor your symptoms. You see, the problem with COVID-19 is that many patients end up suffering with something called silent hypoxia. So hypoxia is when your oxygen levels are low, and silent because it's not giving many symptoms, it's not giving much feedback to you, okay? It's not making you aware that you're hypoxic, so your oxygen levels are low. Unfortunately, this is something that's happening with a lot of COVID-19 patients, so their oxygen levels are dropping and they're getting no symptoms to show them that this is happening, which is where the pulse oximeter comes in handy, because it's able to analyze your oxygen saturations and tell you what your results are. And by doing this, by monitoring your oxygen saturation, you're able to keep a diary and also to know when to seek medical advice. Now I'm going to go through all of this very shortly in this video, but that was just a brief explanation of everything that's going on. So let's now dive in. So let's begin with using your pulse oximeter. I'm going to give you a quick guide on how to use these properly. The first thing you need to remember before you use a pulse oximeter, you need to rest. You need to rest for at least 5 minutes. This is going to mean that your heart rate is going to drop, so you're going to relax more, and also your oxygen saturation is going to normalize as well. So first things first, rest for 5 minutes before we do anything. So once you're fully rested, we can now move on to step one. I know we're super excited to use the pulse oximeter, but we need to wash our hands first. This is super important because if there's any dirt or anything like that on the hands, it's going to affect our results. In addition to this, if you wear nail varnish or if you have false nails or anything like that, you need to remove them. Again, it's going to affect our result because you know how this works. You know how it works through the light and how it checks the ratio to actually calculate your oxygen saturation and your heart rate. So anything like that is going to reduce our results. So remove them all, wash the hands. Another quick tip as well is to wash them in warm water, okay? Because if we have got low blood flow in our hands, because our hands are freezing, they're going to give us a lower result than it actually is. So wash your hands in warm water. This is going to help get that blood flowing as well. And if your hands are still cold, give them a nice rub. Give them a quick rub for a couple of minutes just to get that heat in them. Okay, so moving on to step number two, we're now ready to use our pulse oximeter. So the next thing we're going to do is you're going to put your hand on your chest like this, okay? It can be your right hand, it can be your left hand, it really doesn't matter, okay? After it's steadied for a bit, you're going to put the pulse oximeter on your index finger. That's the finger that's next to your thumb, okay? Some pulse oximeters, you need to switch them on. Mine, for example, here that I use, you just put it on and it switches on automatically, okay? It really depends on which device you have. So I'm going to place it on the index finger like so and leave it there. It will switch on in a couple of seconds. Mine beeps as well, quite annoyingly like that. I've never understood how to switch it off. So it keeps beeping like that with your pulse rate. My pulse rate is quite high right now because I'm very excited that I'm filming. And you're gonna keep it like that for a minute, okay? You're gonna keep it like that for a minute until it steadies out. You're gonna keep looking at it. Make sure you know exactly which one is your oxygen saturation and which one is your pulse, because they don't really put them out very clearly. And the last thing you want is to read your pulse as your oxygen saturation, okay? So leave it on for a minute. If it's steady, then note those levels down, note your oxygen saturation down and your heart rate. If it's unsteady after a minute, then look at it for another 5 seconds and note down the highest readings that you get. So the highest pulse oxygen saturation you get and the highest heart rate that you get, okay? So mine actually analyzes it at the end and gives you a result. I think it's saying that I've got poor signal at the moment, but measure again. But that's because I was talking, but you're not meant to talk, you're meant to stay silent and just do it and then write down your results in your diary. Now, with regards to keeping a diary, you should try and do your tests at the same time each day. I'd advise you to do it 3 times a day minimum. But also, if at any point you're feeling a bit unwell, if you're feeling a bit different or a bit weird, just do some more tests as well and note them in your diary too. Now, I know what you're thinking. You're probably thinking, well, where do I get this diary from? Well, not to worry. Abraham the Pharmacist, I've got your back. I'm going to leave it in the description below, a nice link to an NHS link, which is the diary for you. You can print it out, you can do it online, whatever's easier for you. Okay, so now that we've used our pulse oximeter, remember there's going to be 2 numbers that are written down. But what do they mean? What do these readings mean? So, it's really important that you know which one is your pulse rate and which one is your oxygen saturation. So really get used to reading your machine. It's always a bit difficult when you first put your finger in it because you're sometimes looking at it upside down. So really get used to knowing where the numbers are and what they mean. So let's start with the heart rate, okay? Sometimes on the machine it will write PR, which means pulse rate, or it will write BPM, which means beats per minute, okay? All of them are the same thing. So heart rate, pulse rate, BPM, beats per minute, they're all the same thing. So it's essentially telling you how many beats your heart is beating per minute, okay? And this will usually be ideally between 50 to 90, okay? That's the normal range. The next thing you need to look at is the oxygen saturation. So remember, it's a percentage value. So it's gonna usually have a percent sign followed by SpO2, and O2 we all know is oxygen. Okay, so that's showing our oxygen saturation, and ideally this number should be between 95 to 100%. So now let's talk about these results. Let's talk about the oxygen saturation. Let's talk about the worst case scenario first. So the red light, the super important one that you all need to know. So if your oxygen saturation is 92% or less, so 92% or less, repeat that test again. If again it is below, it's either 92% or less, you need to seek medical attention urgently. So either take yourself to accident and emergency, the emergency department, or call 999 for an ambulance if you can't take yourself there. This is super important because you are going to need urgent medical assistance. You're gonna need medical help straight away. This is super important that you remember that. So 92% or less is red. That's the one that's the most important thing that you need to take from this video. Now, another thing to mention is that you should also ring 999 or go to A&E if you're struggling to breathe for any reason. You're feeling seriously ill, you're feeling really breathless all of a sudden, it's getting worse, you're struggling to speak, you're struggling to say a full sentence whilst resting because you're running out of air, you just feel like you can't breathe. These are all symptoms and indicators that you should seek medical help urgently. That's super important, please remember that. Now, in addition to all of these, there's more reasons again why you should seek urgent medical attention. I'm gonna leave them all here somewhere. We're gonna have them listed all here, but please remember, read the description below as well. I'm gonna explain them in even more detail, but get used to these, remember them. It's really important for your own health and safety that you know these and when to seek medical advice urgently. If you're getting any of these sort of symptoms, you need to be calling 999 immediately or going to A&E immediately because you're gonna need some urgent medical assistance. So now that we've gone through the red light emergency scenarios where you need to get medical assistance urgently, I wanna go through the amber scenarios. The amber ones are, again, they're serious, but they don't require medical emergency treatment yet. What I mean by that is you don't need to ring 999 or go to the emergency department, but if you've got any of these sort of amber symptoms, you need to speak to your doctor or you need to speak to NHS 111 and make them aware of these symptoms. You need to make them aware so they're actively monitoring you as well, okay? This is super important. So the things you need to look out for: is if you're feeling more ill with time, and if it's lasting for 2 hours or more, this could be a sign that they need to be aware of. Or when you're standing up, if you're feeling very breathless and struggling to breathe when you're standing up, again, you need to make your healthcare professionals aware. Another thing is, if you've been ill for 3 weeks or more, again, you need to make them aware of this. And lastly, is your oxygen saturation. If your oxygen saturation is between 93 to 94%, you need to make them aware of it, and especially if it's staying like that. So after an hour or 2 hours, you're constantly monitoring it, and it's staying around 93 to 94%, again, this is the amber light needs to be flicking in your head, and you need to think, I need to let my doctor know, I need to let NHS 111 know about this, so you can be actively monitored. This is very important, and again, I'm gonna break it down in more detail in the description. If any of this doesn't make sense at all, read the description for more detail on it all. You should also check in with your doctor if at any point you don't feel like your normal self. So for example, if you start to struggle with daily tasks, find that you don't want to eat as much, you feel weak or tired, or are peeing less than usual. Now, I am gonna leave more information in the description below, as I've said, but the take home message is, if anything makes you feel something is wrong, then please speak to your healthcare professional. Now, if you have been given a pulse oximeter from your doctor's surgery because you've been diagnosed with a positive COVID test, it might be one of the reasons behind it might be that they're worried that you might be at risk of having more symptoms associated with COVID-19. So you might be at higher risk and you might be more vulnerable because of it, which is why they've given you the pulse oximeter to monitor you actively so that you can monitor the oxygen saturation levels constantly and keep them updated if there's any changes. And because of this high risk level, it's really important that you do make your friends and family aware of it. So give them a ring, send them a message or whatever, ask them to give you a call every day or so, just to see how you're doing. Because just by talking to you, they can also get an understanding of how you're doing on that day and how you're progressing, if you're getting worse, if you're getting better. It's really important to involve other people via telephone calls, obviously not in person, just so they can monitor you as well. I think this is a really good precautionary measure to take just by speaking to your friends and family every day, especially whilst you've got COVID-19 and you're going to be getting better, hopefully. But also, they can listen to you, they can listen to how you're breathing when you're speaking on the phone, they can listen to see how you're progressing, like I said earlier, but it's just an extra precautionary measure that you can take, which is really, really helpful. Now, if you do want more information on COVID-19 care and any advice around it, I will leave loads more information in the description below. I'm also going to leave some NHS links, which have got loads of really helpful information for any patients who are suffering with COVID-19. If you haven't read up about it, if you want more information on it, please do click on that link and find out more. Now, another thing that I'd just like to mention is to please continue using your pulse oximeter for at least 14 days after you get the symptoms of COVID-19. The reason I'm saying this is, sometimes with COVID-19 patients, they tend to get a lot better after 7 days, let's say, and then they stop using the pulse oximeter. And sometimes after you've got better, you can have a dip again and get worse. These symptoms can get worse. So it's really important that you continue using the pulse oximeter for at least 14 days when your symptoms first begin. This is really important, and it's gonna just give us that extra bit of information when it comes to your care. When you've done with it, when you're all finished and you're fully recovered from COVID-19, you can then put it in the bag that it came in, give it a quick clean, and hand it back to your surgery, however they've explained for you to do that. So I really hope you found this information useful. I think pulse oximeters are definitely a good thing to have, and I think even if your surgery doesn't give you one, it would definitely be worth purchasing one. The reason being is, it's kind of like the way I think about it is when you think of thermometers or blood pressure cuffs that people have in their home. As a healthcare professional, we now get patients who have pulse oximeters at home. It makes our life a lot easier when we're speaking to them. They can do a test there and then on the phone for us, let us know their saturation levels. And it's just another aid that can help with clinical diagnosis, I guess. They're relatively inexpensive as well. I think they usually cost about £20 to £30. These ones, that are the clippy ones, are a lot cheaper to buy. These are the ones that I've been using for a long time, and they will last you a lifetime as long as you're careful with them. I don't treat mine very well. They don't last me too long, but I do get a lot of use out of them as well. I think one important thing as well, if you are wanting to purchase one, because I'm getting a lot of questions about these from the viewers, is just to look for the CE sign. I don't know if you can see that. I'll try and make that focus. So you can see that CE sign. That's super important that it's got that. That just means that it abides to the European regulations, so it's been regulated and it works properly. Please make sure you got that sign. There are also other pulse oximeters as well. There's the ring ones that are now quite popular, but they're a lot more expensive. You kind of put them on your finger like so, as if you're wearing a ring. These are a lot more expensive, usually over £100-£200, but they can link to your phone, and you know, you can really analyze that data if you're really into that. There's also other ringy ones which are a bit more complex, but to be honest with you, I would just go with these. These are simple, they work really well, they're cheap, they're inexpensive, everyone can have them and they'll last you so long. That's the end of this week's video. I really hope you found this information helpful. You now know all about pulse oximeters, you now know how they work, you now know how to analyze the results, you know what to do in the red, amber scenarios, you now know when to seek medical advice, which is really important. Thank you for watching. You're gonna be a pulse oximeter pro now, so tell your friends, tell your family, tell your loved ones. Tell everyone, because you know what there is to know. I will see you next week, 4 p.m. GMT, and as always, sending awesome vibes. Hey guys, thanks for watching this week's video. Make sure to click that like, follow, or subscribe button now to stay up to date with new weekly videos.